Hello everyone, today we're talking about one of the most curious and neat clades of amniotes out there. So, let's jump right in. So, turtles. What the heck are they? They're definitely amniotes, but not mammals or birds. Therefore, they fit somewhere among the reptilian sauropsids, but where exactly is up for debate? Are they the last survivors of the anapsid parareptiles, or diapsids pretending to be anapsids? If they are diapsids, are they saurians or not? If they are saurians, are they closer to archosaurs or lepidosaurs? Their fossil history has been rather confusing, and even genetic data has only helped somewhat. Then, where do turtles fit? Before we dive into that question, let's start with what we know about turtles that's not as controversial. First, a clarification. The way terms like turtles and tortoises are commonly used is often very different from their taxonomic definitions, which makes discussing turtle systematics often very confusing to the layman. In systematic classification, turtle is used to refer to all members of the taxonomic order Testudines, which includes a wide variety of species that are specialized to live in marine, freshwater, or terrestrial habitats. The term tortoise is reserved to one specific family of turtles, Testudinidae, which are fully terrestrial. Although there are some terrestrial turtles outside this family that look a lot like tortoises, such as the box turtle, they are actually more closely related to pond turtles. Regardless of the many differences between the subgroups, Testudines as a whole have a set of unique and extensively modified traits, making them one of the most derived and radically transformed group of vertebrates. And I'm not only referring to just the shell. They have a reduced number of cervical and posterior dorsal vertebrae, increased number of manual and pedal phalanges, and a keratinous beak without any teeth. The skull is that of an anapsid as it has no temporal fenestra, but there is often significant emargination of the temporal skull roof. The shell itself is made up of two main parts, the dorsal carapace and the ventral plastron. Both parts have a bony endochondral skeleton that is covered by broad keratinous scales. Both layers have identifiable elements, but the bony and keratinous elements don't match perfectly with each other one-to-one. The bones of the plastron are modified from clavicles and gastralia, or belly ribs, while those of the carapace are composites of modified ribs, vertebrae, and dermal bone. As a consequence of the rigid shell, there is no room for the ribs to expand for breathing, so turtles breathe by contracting muscles on the posterior limiting membrane and on the shoulder girdle, which is situated inside the shell, effectively lying inside the ribcage. Such an arrangement is just bizarre in comparison to that of all other tetrapods. Within the Testudines, turtles break into two groups, Pleurodira and Cryptodira. These two split prior to the breakup of Pangaea in the late Jurassic. From there, Pleurodires were stuck in Gondwana, while the Cryptodires were stuck in Laurasia. Aside from location, these turtles are distinguished by the way they retract their necks. Pleurodires swing their necks to the side when retracting, while Cryptodires pull their heads straight back. The 2017 paper, A Jurassic Stem Pleurodire, sheds light on the functional origin of neck retraction in turtles, argues that pulling the neck in for protection is an exaptation, that turtles were originally using their retractable necks to capture prey underwater. Now, there are a number of families within Pleurodira, including Chelidae, Pelomedusidae, and Podocnemididae. The first contains Austro-South American species such as the Matamata and includes members capable of cloacal breathing. The second contains a single species, Pelomedusa subrufa, the African helmeted turtle. The last family, Podocnemididae, contains a number of turtles from South America and Madagascar, such as the yellow-spotted river turtle. One notable extinct member of this family is Carbonemys, one of the largest freshwater turtles that ever lived. It lived alongside the gigantic boid, Titanoboa, during a warming period that led to the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum 55 million years ago, as we saw in the previous video on paleoclimatology. Cryptodires, on the other hand, seem to be native to Eurasia, but dispersed to North America at least twice. The most basal member of this clade is Trionychia, the soft-shelled turtles. More derived than them is the clade Emerichelidia, containing sea turtles, snapping turtles, and river and mud turtles. This clade evidently dispersed to North America during the Cretaceous, and the largest sea turtle ever discovered, the late Cretaceous Arculan, hails from this group. Sister to Americhalidia is Testudinoidea, which is then split into Testuguria and Emisternia. Testuguria contains Testudinidae and Geoemididae. The former houses the tortoises, while the latter has a large number of Eurasian pond and river turtles. Finally, Emisternia contains Emididae, which are often called terrapins, most of which are native to the Americas, and Platysternan megacephalum, the big-headed turtle, a single species placed in its own family, Platysternidae, sister to Emididae. So far, we have talked about Testudines, which is a crown group that includes the common ancestor of all extant turtles and all its descendants. There is a more inclusive group called Testudinata, tetrapods possessing a fully formed turtle shell with a plastron and carapace. It includes Testudines and many extinct relatives that also had the turtle shell. These would have looked pretty much like turtles, but they are more properly referred to as stem turtles since they fall outside the Testudine crown group. In their recent paper published in January 2019, Evers and Benson reconstructed a phylogenetic tree of Testudinata. This new tree puts many extinct groups that were normally considered to be cryptodires outside the Testudine taxon as stem turtles. The stem turtle clade they recovered as sister to the Testudines was named Angola acalonia, containing members that were previously placed within the clade Americhalidia as close relatives of sea turtles. If this new phylogeny is correct, Angola acalonia made the transition to marine life independently from the sea turtles we have today. More distantly related shelled stem turtles were the odd Myolaniids, which had long armored tails and, of all things, horns on their heads, but, sadly, no hooves. They are known from the Cenozoic, but their distribution in South America and Oceania suggests that this lineage originated before the continents of Gondwana drifted apart during the Cretaceous. Thus, Myolaniids represented an ancient lineage of stem turtles that survived the K-PG extinction event, and they managed to survive until very recently. One Myolaniid from Queensland, Australia, that lived during the Pleistocene is Ninjamese, a name that translates to Ninja Turtle. Quoting verbatim from the paper, this name is, quote, an allusion to that totally rad, fearsome foursome epitomizing shelled success, close quote. Another recent survivor is Myolania, a genus widely distributed in the Southwest Pacific, and some species could reach enormous sizes. Remains of a species found on Efate Island in Vanuatu were dated to be between 3,000 and 2,500 years old, showing that Myolania survived long enough to encounter the first human settlers, and were probably driven to extinction by their interactions shortly thereafter. The earliest stem turtle with both a plastron and carapace is Proganachelys from 210 million years ago. Its neck and tail were armored with dermal bone that isn't part of the shell. The armored tail was independently derived from those of the previously mentioned Myolaniids. But apart from that, externally it was very turtle-like, with a beak and no marginal teeth. However, unlike true turtles, Proganachelys still had denticles on the palate, i.e. teeth on the roof of the mouth, and it couldn't retract its head, legs, or tail into the shell. So certainly not a complete turtle, but it did have a complete shell. How did that uniquely turtle trait evolve? Historically, there were two competing hypotheses for the origin of the carapace. The osteoderm, or composite hypothesis, argued that the shell evolved by the acquisition and expansion of osteoderms, and later the ribs and the spine were fused to these osteoderms. The de novo hypothesis holds that the shell formed by the broadening of the ribs and vertebrae, which later formed outgrowths that became the bony elements of the shell. The latter hypothesis was supported by the ontogeny, since turtles broaden their ribs as the first step in the development of the shell, but the former hypothesis was supported by some paleontological data that was available at the time. This changed in 2008 when a new turtle relative was described, Odontochelys from 220 million years ago, close enough to Proganachelys from 210 million years ago that we should suspect a lot of the relevant relatives are still missing from the fossil record. Fascinatingly, this turtle has only a plastron but no carapace or top shell, so it doesn't belong within Testudinata. Its name also refers to the fact that it had marginal teeth, quite unlike any modern turtles. Despite not having a carapace, it did have broadened ribs and vertebrae that aren't associated with osteoderms, thereby corroborating the de novo hypothesis. But one might ask whether it really does prove that the turtle shell evolved by first acquiring the plastron before the carapace. Perhaps Odontochelys could be a descendant of a fully shelled ancestor, but then secondarily lost the carapace. However, the clue that Odontochelys represents a genuine intermediate form lies in its shoulders. As previously mentioned, the shoulder girdle of turtles are positioned inside the ribs of the shell, whereas those of all other tetrapods are positioned outside the ribcage. Such a radical reconfiguration seems impossible to derive via a gradual evolutionary process, but evo devo to the rescue. By comparing the development of turtles with other amniotes, Nagashima et al. Showed that all of them start off with the shoulders outside the ribs. But in later stages of development, turtles have their shoulders positioned further towards the front, and their ribs remain short and are angled towards the back. Then, after further development, the muscle plate folds inward, while the second pair of ribs grows outward and swing forward. This brings the shoulder girdles within the confines of the ribs. Before the ribs start to expand, forming the shell, the muscle that connects the shoulder blades to the second pair of ribs, called the serratus anterior, retains its ancestral attachment to both bones, but it becomes twisted as a result of this reconfiguration. The position of the shoulder girdle in Odontochelys mirrors that of modern turtles in the intermediate stage of development, with the girdle positioned anterior to short ribs that are angled backwards, supporting the conclusion that Odontochelys represented the ancestral condition of turtles. More recently, in 2018, another stem turtle called Eorhynchocheles from 230 million years ago was described. Not only being older than Odontochelys, it's also less derived as it lacks both a plastron and carapace, but still has broadened ribs. Curiously, while having teeth, it also had a beak, which the later Odontochelys didn't possess. Perhaps Eorhynchocheles evolved the beak independently, or the beak was secondarily lost in Odontochelys. In either case, it shows that the evolution of the beak in turtles wasn't a straight path. Going another 10 million years further back in time, we find in Papocheles, hailing from 240 million years ago, or just after the start of the Triassic. It was described in 2015 and is comparable to Eorhynchocheles, as it also lacks a plastron and carapace. It has broadened ribs and robust gastralia that form the beginning of the plastron, but it does lack a beak. Then, another 20 million years further back, we come to the earliest definitive relative of turtles, Eunotosaurus, described in the late 1800s. It's a very lizard-like reptile from the late Permian, some 260 million years ago. Only a few characteristics identify this amniote as a turtle relative, such as a reduction of dorsal vertebrae and broadened T-shaped ribs. The very beginning of what would eventually become the turtle shell. But these adaptations likely didn't serve the same function as the modern turtle shell for protection. In 2016, Lyson et al. Argued that these earliest modifications provided early stem turtles more stability and leverage for a fossorial, or digging, lifestyle, which likely helped stem turtles survive the end Permian mass extinction. So just like the retractable neck of turtles, the shell is another example of an evolutionary exaptation. So far, apart from a few contentious details, we seem to have a pretty good picture of turtle evolution, including how the turtle shell evolved. First, by broadening of the ribs and reduction of the dorsal vertebrae, followed by the broadening of the gastralia to form the plastron, and the anterior positioning of the shoulder girdle within the short ribs angled backwards. And then at the final stage, we have the movement of the shoulder girdle below the ribs, and then these expand to form the carapace. So, what's the problem? The heated controversy surrounding turtle evolution isn't exactly about their evolution from something like Eunotosaurus. It's about their phylogenetic position among amniotes, specifically within Sauropsida. This problem stems from the fact that turtles have such a radically transformed morphology, which makes identifying synapomorphies, or shared derived traits, between them and other amniotes very difficult. It also doesn't help that the early evolution of reptiles during the Permian and Triassic consisted of relatively short adaptive radiation events that probably erased many of the morphological traits that they originally shared. Historically, turtles have been considered the only surviving members of the clade Anapsida, which is nowadays called Parareptilia. As we've mentioned in other videos, there are three major clades of amniotes: anapsids, synapsids, and diapsids. Each clade has been historically identified by the number of temporal fenestrae they possess. Anapsids have none, synapsids 1, and diapsids 2. Because turtles, as well as the most basal stem turtles like Eunotosaurus, have no temporal fenestrae, They have been grouped with all the other amniotes bearing this feature, or rather lack thereof. Anapsida includes the Millerettids, Perisaurs, and Procolophonids, among others, which all died out at the end of the Permian. Turtles were considered to have stemmed from either of the latter two. This description held for quite a long time. Things were changing by the 90s, though, as some paleontological studies recovered turtles as diapsids rather than anapsids, placing them sister to Sauropterygia. This is a clade of aquatic and semi-aquatic amniotes, ranging from placodonts to nothosaurs to plesiosaurs. Then came the numerous molecular studies that moved turtles in a similar direction, away from the anapsid position. The 1998 paper, Complete Mitochondrial Genomes, suggests diapsid affinities of turtles. The 1999 paper, Molecular Evidence for a Clade of Turtles. And the 2005 paper, Sister Group Relationship of Turtles to the Bird Crocodilian Clade Revealed by Nuclear DNA-Coded Proteins, conclude that turtles are sister to the archosaurs, the birds and crocodilians. Together, turtles and archosaurs form the clade Archelosauria, where their common ancestor lived about 265 million years ago, just prior to the start of the Triassic. So, case closed, right? Turtles are sister to archosaurs. Well, not exactly. While genetic studies have favored the sisterhood to archosaurs, a number of morphological studies recovered turtles as being sister to the lepidosaurs, the lizards, snakes, and tuatara. This forms the clade Ankylopoda, which places the common ancestor of turtles and lepidosaurs, again in the Permian. At this point, despite numerous molecular studies pointing towards a diapsid affinity for turtles, many paleontologists remain skeptical about this, preferring the anapsid position based on the fact that, at the time, all the known stem turtles had anapsid skulls. And those who favored the diapsid affinity proposed that Eunotosaurus was unrelated to turtles, and that its shared traits with turtles were the result of convergent evolution, which the previous paleontologists didn't like. However, in 2015, the paper, A Middle Triassic Stem Turtle and the Evolution of the Turtle Body Plan, described Papachelles as a stem turtle that did possess two temporal fenestrae. It was a diapsid. The study also recovered the Ankylopoda position of turtles as sister to lepidosaurs. But what about the earlier stem turtle Eunotosaurus? It still has an anapsid skull, right? Well, in the same year, Bever et al. Showed that it did possess a supratemporal fenestra as a juvenile, which is later covered with dermal bone in adults. Since then, paleontologists have largely considered turtles to be diapsids, and sister to Sauropterygia, as previously mentioned. Both are now classified under the clade Pantestudines, which is defined as turtles, plus their extinct relatives more closely related to them than to any other extant group. However, where it fits within Diapsida is disputed. Turtles were solidified as diapsids thanks to genetics, and then finally corroborated by paleontology. Which clade of diapsids they belong to, though, is now the question. The debate continues to rage about the exact placement of turtles. Sauropterygia, as sister to the turtles, makes a fair bit of sense, as a number of placodonts independently evolved shells like turtles, such as Cephaderma and Hinotus. While Hinotus had a shell that superficially looked like those of sea turtles, the shell of Cephaderma was articulated into two pieces, such that it resembled the carapace of horseshoe crabs. But these shells also independently evolved from each other, as the earliest members of both clades are small, lizard-like forms. This also makes sense because diapsids were undergoing a major adaptive radiation following the Permian-Triassic extinction event, and major evolutionary events tend to start with small, generalized forms that gradually diversify, often giving rise to many convergent forms. We saw this with the origin of dinosaurs previously, and living alongside them were pseudosuchians that convergently evolved a dinosaur-like body plan, such as the bipedal Poposaurus and Chivosaurus. And this principle has even made the origin of amniotes difficult to study, where several basal forms have routinely jumped around the lower branches. Recently, this has included mesosaurs and varanopids. And a reminder is in order on the geology of this. Plate tectonics has subducted and overlaid lots of the ocean, meaning there are very few places where rocks of the right time frame exist to look at, and above water for paleontologists to dig in. So that's the turtles. They are amniotes sitting somewhere within Diapsida that developed a shell. From their early days in the Triassic, they have stretched across the continents, leaving an impressive record of fossils. So, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.